We're going home to Denmark.
And boy did I have trouble finding a plane. Apparently the company I bought the ticket with went under. I had to buy new tickets yesterday. That's expensive.
This is not a product placement. This is the fourth of these I'm returning. Don't buy them. Stick to boosted board. Please just take it.
Taking the wrong train. Brilliant, I'm somewhere in Oakland. Today, I thought we would talk about this.
Are we headed toward a future without jobs? The fear that automation might displace workers and potentially lead to lots of unemployment goes back at a minimum 200 years. And since then, this concern has come up again and again.
The UN Food and Agriculture Organization put out an alert. We have 1 billion people on the verge of hunger and starvation.
Every technology revolution we call social instability. The first technology revolution, I say, caused World War I. Second technology revolution caused World War II. This is the third technology revolution. People are already unhappy because a lot of machine learning, artificial intelligence killing a lot of jobs. People start to worry. If you're not innovative enough, if you're not like creative enough, your job will be taken away by a lot of machines.
On the artificial intelligence front, I have exposure to the very most cutting edge AI, and I think people should be really concerned about it. AI is a rare case where I think we need to be proactive in regulation instead of reactive, because I think by the time we are reactive in AI regulation, it's too late.
And I do think that when the computer takes over certain tasks, that'll be tough for us. It would be a long time before you're matching the type of broad judgment that humans exercise in many different areas.
There's no institution in the world that cannot be improved with machine learning.
We live in a very interesting time because there are a few golden ages happening, and one of them is machine learning, and we're doing everything with it. We're grading strawberries with it, for Amazon Fresh.
I'm gonna guess that most of you have probably never heard of the Triple Revolution Report. And this report was presented to the President of the United States, and it argued that the US was on the brink of economic and social upheaval because industrial automation was gonna put millions of people out of work. Now that report was delivered to President Lyndon Johnson in March of 1964. That's now over 50 years, and of course that hasn't really happened. And that's been the story again and again. Technology may devastate entire industries. It may wipe out whole occupations and types of work. But at the same time, progress is going to lead to entirely new things. So there will be new industries, there'll be new kinds of work that will appear. And that has been the story so far, and it's been a positive story. But there is one particular class of worker for whom the story has been quite different. For these workers, technology has completely decimated their work, and it really hasn't created any new opportunities at all. And these workers, of course, are horses. Is it possible that at some point in the future, a significant fraction of the human workforce is going to be made redundant in the way that horses were? You might say, that's absurd. How can you possibly compare human beings to horses? We can learn, we can adapt, and in theory, that ought to mean that we can always find something new to do and that we can always remain relevant to the future economy. Here's the really critical thing to understand. The future is going to be full of thinking, learning, adapting machines.
We see a world, a nanosecond from here, where data enables machine learning, understanding through repetition and recognition, adapting and adjusting as we do.
What that really means is that technology is finally beginning to encroach on that fundamental human capability, the very thing that so far has allowed us to stay ahead of the march of progress and remain relevant and, in fact, indispensable to the economy.
If you wanted to get a computer to do something new, you would have to program in excruciating detail every single step that you want the computer to achieve. Now, if you want to do something that you don't know how to do yourself, then this is going to be a great challenge. This man, Arthur Samuel, wanted to get this computer to be able to beat him at checkers. So he came up with an idea. He had the computer play against itself thousands of times and learn how to play checkers. It worked. And in fact, by 1962, this computer had beaten the Connecticut state champion. So Arthur Samuel was the father of machine learning. The first big success of machine learning commercially was Google. Google showed that it is possible to find information by using a computer algorithm. Since that time, there has been many commercial successes of machine learning. So we now know that computers can learn, and computers can learn to do things that we actually sometimes don't know how to do ourselves. A team won a competition for automatic drug discovery. They beat all of the algorithms developed by Merck or the international academic community. Nobody on the team had any background in chemistry or biology or life science. And they did it in 2 weeks. How did they do this? They used an extraordinary algorithm called deep learning. Deep learning is an algorithm inspired by how the human brain works. And as a result, it's an algorithm which has no theoretical limitations on what it can do. The more data you give it and the more computation time you give it, the better it gets.
We've been able to take a large amount of information from many Chinese speakers and produce a text-to-speech system. We've taken an hour or so of my own voice, and we've used that to modulate the standard text-to-speech system so that it would sound like me. Again, the results are not perfect. There are, in fact, quite a few errors.
Deep learning is this extraordinary thing. It's a single algorithm that can seem to do almost anything. In this obscure competition from Germany called the German Traffic Sign Benchmark, deep learning had learnt to recognize traffic signs. Not only could it recognize the traffic signs better than any other algorithm, the leaderboard actually showed it was better than people, about twice as good as people. By 2011, we had the first example of computers that can see better than people. Since that time, a lot has happened. In 2012, Google announced that they had a deep learning algorithm watch YouTube videos. The computer independently learned about concepts such as people and cats. This is much like the way that humans learn. Humans don't learn by being told what they see, but by learning for themselves what these things are. Google announced last year that they had mapped every single location in France in 2 hours. And the way they did it was that they fed street view images into a deep learning algorithm to recognize street numbers. Imagine how long it would have taken before. Dozens of people, many years. In Stanford, a group there announced that looking at tissues under magnification, they've developed a machine learning-based system which, in fact, is better than human pathologists at predicting survival rates for cancer sufferers. The computer system discovered that the cells around the cancer are as important as the cancer cells themselves in making a diagnosis. This is the opposite of what pathologists had been taught for decades. So what does it mean now that computers can see? There's a lack of medical expertise in the world. And it would take about 300 years to train enough people to fix that problem. So imagine if we can help enhance their efficiency using these deep learning approaches. So I'm very excited about the opportunities. I'm also concerned about the problems. The problem here is that every area in blue on this map is somewhere where services are over 80% of employment. What are services? These are services. These are also the exact things that computers have just learned how to do. 80% of the world's employment in the developed world is stuff that computers have just learned how to do. What does that mean? Well, it'll be fine. It'll be replaced by other jobs. For example, there'll be more jobs for data scientists. Well, not really. It doesn't take data scientists very long to build these things. For example, these four algorithms were all built by the same guy. If you think, oh, it's all happened before, we've seen the results in the past of when new things come along and they get replaced by new jobs, it's very hard for us to estimate this because human performance grows at this gradual rate. But we now have a system, deep learning, that we know actually grows in capability exponentially. And we're here. But in 5 years' time, computers will be off this chart. We have seen this once before, of course. In the Industrial Revolution, we saw a step change in capability thanks to engines. The thing is, though, that after a while, things flattened out. Once engines were used to generate power in all the situations, things really settled down. The machine learning revolution is going to be very different to the Industrial Revolution, because the machine learning revolution never settles down.
So what is it that is really so different about today's information technology relative to what we've seen in the past? I would point to three fundamental things. And the first thing is exponential acceleration. Now, I know you all know about Moore's law, but in fact, it's more broad-based than that. It extends in many cases, for example, to software. It extends to communications bandwidth and so forth. The second key thing is that the machines are, in a limited sense, beginning to think. And by this, I don't mean human-level artificial intelligence. I simply mean that machines and algorithms are solving problems, and most importantly, they're learning, machine learning, which is just becoming this incredibly powerful, disruptive, scalable technology. We tend to draw a very distinct line. And on one side of that line are all the jobs and tasks that we perceive as being on some level fundamentally routine and repetitive and predictable. Because they are innately predictable, we know that they're probably at some point going to be susceptible to machine learning and therefore to automation. That's a lot of jobs. That's probably something on the order of roughly half the jobs in the economy. But then on the other side of that line, we have all the jobs that require some capability that we perceive as being uniquely human. And these are the jobs that we think are safe. Now, based on what I know about the game of Go, I would have guessed that it really ought to be on the safe side of that line. But the fact that it isn't and that Google solved this problem suggests that that line is going to be very dynamic. It's going to shift in a way that consumes more and more jobs that we currently perceive as being safe from automation. This is by no means just about low-wage jobs or blue-collar jobs. There's lots of evidence to show that these technologies are rapidly climbing the skills ladder. So as we put these trends together, I think what it shows is that we could very well end up in a future with significant unemployment. So a fundamental economic problem, because jobs are currently the primary mechanism that distributes income and therefore purchasing power to all the consumers. In order to have a vibrant market economy, you've got to have lots and lots of consumers. If you don't have that, then you run the risk of economic stagnation or maybe even a declining economic spiral, as they're simply aren't enough customers out there to buy the products and services being produced. So the question then becomes, what exactly could we do about this? And I think you can view this through a very utopian framework, but at the same time, I think we have to be realistic and we have to realize that we're very likely to face a significant income distribution problem. A lot of people are likely to be left behind. I think that in order to solve that problem, we're ultimately going to have to find a way to decouple incomes from traditional work. And the best way I know to do that is some kind of a guaranteed income or universal basic income. My own view is that a basic income is not a panacea. It's not necessarily a plug-and-play solution, but rather it's a place to start. It's an idea that we can build on and refine. For example, one thing that I have written quite a lot about is the possibility of incorporating explicit incentives into a basic income. Imagine that you are a struggling high school student. Suppose you know that at some point in the future, no matter what, you're going to get the same basic income as everyone else. To my mind, that creates a very perverse incentive for you to simply give up and drop out of school. So I would say, let's not structure things that way. Instead, pay people who graduate from high school somewhat more than those who simply drop out. And we can take that idea of building incentives into a basic income and maybe extend it to other areas. By incorporating incentives into a basic income, we might actually improve it and also perhaps take at least a couple of steps towards solving another problem that I think we're quite possibly going to face in the future. And that is, how do we all find meaning and fulfillment, and how do we occupy our time in a world where perhaps there's less demand for traditional work? Refining a basic income and make it look better, and also perhaps make it more politically and socially acceptable and feasible. I think one of the most kind of fundamental objections to many of us is this fear that we're going to end up with too many people riding in the economic cart and not enough people pulling that cart. And yet really the whole point I'm making here, of course, is that in the future, machines are increasingly going to be capable of pulling that cart for us. That should give us more options for the way we structure our society and our economy. And I think that eventually it's going to go beyond simply being an option and it's going to become an imperative, because jobs are that mechanism that gets purchasing power to consumers so that they can then drive the economy. If that mechanism begins to erode in the future, then we're going to need to replace it with something else, or we're going to face the risk that our whole system simply may not be sustainable. The bottom line here is that I really think that solving these problems, finding a way to build a future economy that works for everyone at every level of our society, is going to be one of the most important challenges that we all face in the coming years and decades.
Anyone who believes in indefinite growth on a physically finite planet is either mad or an economist.
Yes. Thank you.
This is where I check in, right?
Security.
So when it comes to machine learning, there's really two views. Either it'll mess up our entire society.
There'll certainly be a lot of job disruption, because what's going to happen is robots will be able to do everything better than us. I'm including I mean, all of us, you know. I really think we need government regulation here, you know, ensuring the public good is served. Because you've got companies that are racing, that they kind of have to race to build AI or they're going to be made uncompetitive. You know, like, essentially, if your competitor is racing to build AI and you don't, they will crush you.
Or it won't really do much.
I'm really optimistic. Right? I'm an optimistic person in general. I think you can build things and the world gets better. With AI especially, I'm really optimistic.
I'm a little more conservative than Mark Zuckerberg, but I'm definitely not 100% on Elon Musk's side. I do believe it is important for us to draw a line and sort of see what industries will be disrupted and which ones won't. I'm also not on Mark Zuckerberg's side. I really do think that especially when machine learning becomes super intelligent and it sort of becomes an AI, we have to keep an eye on it. But it's really interesting. Let me know what you think. Going to London.
I'm on a plane right now. There's a baby crying. I'm still very happy. You guys have amazing comments.
So the most prominent argument that really came up was that I was a communist or that religion was going to save us. And I just want to point out that politics have absolutely nothing to do with this. We're not talking about what we want to have happen. We're talking about what we think will happen because of how all of the numbers are trending. We don't know if it'll happen in the next 20 years. When Elon Musk says 20 years, that's kind of because he's Elon Musk. Just wanted to make that sure.
Basic economics state that scarcity is a thing, and we kind of have to talk about that.
Why are you silly? I'm playing. Home sweet home. I don't think I agree with people like Mark Zuckerberg or Elon Musk, because I feel like that's a little bit extreme. I think we have to draw a line in the middle. Some industries will be disrupted, some won't. But yeah, the really interesting part about this is the conversation. So tell me what you guys think in the comments down below. And yeah, subscribe to the channel if you're new. Let me know what you think about this vlogumentary. I'll see you guys next week. Take care.